Turkey is strewn with banners for a crisis election. Called 18 months early because the Ecevit coalition has collapsed, battered by defections and charged with corruption and economic mismanagement, and now rescued and burdened with a massive $16 billion bailout loan from the IMF. None of the current coalition parties is expected to win a seat in the next parliament. They need 10% of the vote to do that. And with the electorate angry and volatile, the country's future is in the balance.
It's a race between those who sees Turkey's place in the world, in Europe. And then there are those who are afraid, who worry, who'd rather withdraw into the past, the glorious past. So it's a little bit of a race between courage and fear, I would say.
It's really crucial because Turkish people have been suffering a lot, particularly the last 4 years. Economically, they've been suffering, and also as far as some fundamental rights are concerned, they are suffering.
For many, the only issue is survival. Unemployment rose by 2 million over the past 18 months, and the austerity package to tackle inflation and cut government spending has not made life immediately easier. On the outskirts of Istanbul, the municipality hand out free meals. 3 times more food than when the crisis began, and still not enough.
There's no jobs. I collect paper from the street to sell. I can hardly make ends meet.
The roof leaks. I can't afford to pay my rent. At my age, I'm almost forced to go out begging.
I'm only angry at the people in power, that's all.
Against this bleak background, Turkey celebrated Republic Day. It's 79 years now since Kemal Atatürk founded a state that was to end Turkey's position as the sick man of Europe. But with the country ailing once again, there's no consensus as to what the remedy should be. The parade started with children waltzing, a reminder perhaps that for many, Turkey's future lies in Europe, as a secular state that's also part of the Muslim world, though there's been massive disappointment that the country has thus far been rejected by the EU. Republic Day is a reminder of Atatürk's ideal that this should be a strong secular state and of Turkey's passionate nationalism. Now, a country battered by economic problems and rebuffed by the EU faces a crucial choice between narrow nationalism and a new internationalism. And the front runners in a crucial and bizarre election, a party whose leader has been banned from entering parliament. And this is why. 5 years ago, the then mayor of Istanbul, Tayyip Erdogan, read what was seen as a seditious Islamic religious poem at this rally. It includes the lines, "The mosques are our barracks, the minarets are bayonets." He was jailed and, as a result, banned from holding office. Quite right, argue his opponents.
We see in many countries what happens when religion is used to inflame political opinion. We want to keep politics and religion apart. A leader of a major party in Turkey should respect the secular constitution of the republic and should not use religious language in politics.
So he was wrong?
He was wrong.
And yet Erdogan, the man who's not allowed to become an MP, let alone Prime Minister, is now arguably the most popular politician in Turkey. On a bitterly cold night out in the central Anatolian city of Kayseri, there's a spectacular election rally for the new AK party, led by Erdogan, unofficially if not officially. His exact status was being discussed in court even today. AK are ahead in the polls, although the chief prosecutor has asked for the party to be closed down. a fate that befell both the pro-Islamic welfare and virtue parties, which Erdogan had previously supported. He came on stage in a blitz of fireworks and music, more like a pop star than a subversive fundamentalist. He told the crowd what they want to hear. His party will provide employment. But his critics are suspicious he's still an Islamist. And after the rally, I asked him about that poem that got him banned.
This is not my poem. It's by Ataturk's ideologist. And it's a poem which was suggested by the National Ministry of Education and has been printed in various publications.
But for those in the West who don't know Turkey's history, it makes you sound like a fundamentalist.
We have nothing at all to do with fundamentalism. We are against all forms of radicalism.
So if Erdogan can't be prime minister if his party win, who will be? No one's been named, though the obvious candidate is the deputy Abdullah Gül. Who is going to be the prime minister?
Someone.
Someone.
From us.
Someone from you?
Yes. Someone
yourself?
Someone from the party, of course.
But how can you say, with just a couple of days to go before the election, that you can't announce who the prime minister is going to be? It's an extraordinary situation.
You are right. In fact, it's not good for the democracy. But unfortunately,
people don't really know who they're voting for.
Yes, unfortunately, we are not the reason for that.
AK argue that there's no reason why, as good Muslims, they shouldn't run a secular party that supports Turkey's entry into the EU and continues the economic reforms, though they'd like to make some changes. They'd also repeal the ban on Muslim women wearing headscarves in universities or government offices. If the West have any worries about AK, there are no such concerns about Kemal Dervish. He spent Republic Day at a parade, acting like any good politician. Though until last year, he was a senior official at the World Bank. He returned to secure the IMF loan and oversee the economic reforms, but resigned from the government in July. Now he's aligned to another party, second in the polls, and is sceptical as to whether his rivals, AK, really would support the IMF deal.
That's what they're saying outside of Turkey. They're not saying it in the town hall meetings inside Turkey. And that's worrisome. I think time has come in Turkish politics that people should say what they really think.
But there's one party that worries the West and the IMF more than any other. Ultra-nationalist with big money to spend on a pop campaign. Cem Uzan may face racketeering charges in the US, but with a volatile electorate, the time seems right for a wild card candidate.
Cem Uzan geliyor!
And they don't come much more wild than Cem Uzan. He's a very rich businessman who's embroiled in a whole variety of court cases and promises the world, sending his messages to the electorate through his own mobile system. The network today promises he'll work for the good of the country, and through his own newspaper. Today he promises that the IMF will be finished in Turkey in 48 hours.
What Turkey needs is a leader offering stability and honesty. But with the most popular politician in the country barred, and a whole variety of different new coalitions quite possible, there's no clear indication of who will take over after Sunday's vote.